Is it just BPT or BOT students are also here?
BPT.
Only BPT. BOT people have their exams right now, right? Okay. So, I in my previous class had finished up teaching you about rehabilitative psychology and what all is the scope of rehabilitation psychology, what is the process, what is the need and the steps, right? In terms of psychological aspect, how disability is viewed, different models of disability, all of that I had completed. I'll also be sharing the PPT and the reading material on your WhatsApp group. So you can go through and read on that. And I have also read your assignments. I'll give you feedback on that as well. Another unit I'm not able to connect, but another unit that I want to start with today is perceptual processes. Okay, this particular topic would basically deal with the psychological aspects of sensation and perception. Okay, we have already covered learning theories. We have all read about personality. Now we go to the sensory aspect and how human beings perceive their sensory stimulus. Okay, so starting with what is perception really? Okay, it is basically the method by which the sensation experienced at any given moment are interpreted and organized in some meaningful ways. So then, what all are our sensory modalities? What all sensory modalities do we have? We have vision, we have smell, we have touch, right? We have hearing, right? We have tasting, right? All of these are our sensory modalities, right? So whatever that we are experiencing through our sensory modalities, how exactly are we interpreting them or what meaning we are given to them, right? So our tongue is feeling what we are tasting, that is sensory. But whether we perceive it as good tasting or bad tasting, that is our perception. Okay? So if I'm hearing something, that is my sensation. But how I interpret or give meaning to what I'm hearing, that is perception. Okay? So the method by which these sensations experienced at any given moment are interpreted, given meaning to, and are organized in any meaningful way. Because at all moments of time, we are receiving a lot of sensory input at any given point, right? But we hear something, we give it meaning, we attend to certain information, we don't attend to certain information. At this moment, you may be hearing a lot of things, but you are focusing on one particular, sensory stimulus, and you are giving a meaning to it. Okay, that is basically perception. So while our sensory receptors are constantly collecting information from the environment, it is ultimately how we interpret that information, and that affects how we interact with the world. So basically, our perception leads to our actions. Our perceptions are what leads to the behavior that we take up, and not what we receive from our sensory input. Okay? Perception refers to the way sensory information is organized, interpreted, and consciously experienced. Perception involves both bottom-up and top-down processing. Now, what is bottom-up processing? It, of course, as name suggests, it goes from bottom to up. It refers to the fact that perceptions are built from our sensory input. On the other hand, how we interpret those sensations is influenced by our available knowledge, experiencing, and our thought. This is called top-down processing. So both the processing is happening simultaneously. The perception happens why? Because we are getting some sort of sensory input. But how we are processing is basically dependent on our knowledge, our experiencing, our thought. Okay? So I am saying something to you, right? You all are receiving the same sensory input. But what information that I say you are attending to depends on your level of experience, your thoughts, what thoughts you already have about the topic of perception, what experiences you have had related to, this lecture or this, psychology subject. So while all of you are receiving the same information, you are receiving the same sensory input, but you all in your minds are giving different meaning to what I'm saying. That is basically your perception. Okay, so sensation is completely a physical process. There is no psychology involved in the way we are sensing the stimulus by our sensory modalities. But when we talk about perception, it is entirely psychological. Okay? For example, upon walking into a kitchen and smelling the scent of baking cinnamon rolls, the sensation is the scent receptors, right? That is pure biology, right? It is sensing that there is a certain smell. Okay, it is the scent receptors detecting the odor of cinnamon. But the perception can be something like, wow, this smells like the bread my grandma used to make when the family gathered for holidays. Okay, so based on your knowledge, your experience and your memories, you are giving it a certain meaning, that is your perception. Okay, while some other person who is walking into the same kitchen can have an aversive reaction to it. Oh, this smells like something, you know, I had and I felt sick the last time I had something like this. So they may give it a completely different perception, while you are somebody else is giving it a positive perception. Okay, so perception is entirely a psychological process. Now, what is the importance of understanding perception? Why is perception relevant? Because perception is a very, very important aspect into understanding human behavior. It's a very important indicator of understanding human behavior because every person perceives the world and approaches life problems differently, right? So if say that, you know, there's a faculty and they give, you know, a very negative remark to the entire class. Now the whole class is receiving that sensory input. The whole class is hearing what, you know, the teacher is saying. But everybody's reaction to it is different. Everybody's, you know, way of dealing with it is different. Why? That is all in all their perception and interpretation of what happened or what the sensory input they had. Okay, and hence that is why it is important indication in understanding human behavior and understanding that each individual has their own idiosyncratic or unique way of responding to their sensory information, and not all human beings are same. Our perception is a byproduct of our life experiences, our knowledge, our memory, and also of course our intellect and lots of other things. Okay, so that is how it is important in understanding human behavior, because every person perceives world and approaches life problems very differently. Whatever we feel or see is not necessarily the same as it really is. When we buy something, it is not because it is the best, but because we take it to be the best. Okay, for some other person it may not be the best, but for a particular person it may be purely because of their perception of that particular object. Okay, so of course perception is applicable in everything. It is applicable in your life decision, when we have patients coming here, when we deal with patients who have psychological problems. Most of their problems are a result of their perception of the life events that happen to them, right? And everybody perceives their life events differently, right? So we also work on towards having teaching them a bit more, you know, logical way of processing their sensory information. Also, perception involves is very much related to consumer behavior also, right? So branding, advertising, it is all an interplay of customer perception, that how we want our, you know, buyers to perceive our product. Okay, so it all is a play of perception. If people behave on the basis of their perception, we can predict their behavior in the changed circumstances by understanding their present perception of the environment. One person may be viewing the facts in one way, while some other person have a very different viewpoint or a very different way they see those facts, right? So if I give you a certain question, you all will have a different perception to it, and you all will brainstorm and give me different ways to solve that same problem. Okay, because you all are viewing that problem from your set of perception, your experiences. If I say this is the problem, what will you do now? So one person will say based on their experiences. Other person who has dealt through the same problem will talk from their own experience. Okay? So that is what perception is all about. With the help of perception, the needs of various people can be determined, because people's perception is influenced by also their needs and their aspirations. Okay, just giving few more examples to help you understand what perception is. Perception is very important for the manager who wants to avoid making errors when dealing with people and events in the work setting. This problem is made more complicated by the fact that different people perceive the same problem or situation differently. In order to deal with subordinates effectively, the managers must understand their perceptions properly. That if I take this decision today, how is each and every person in this, you know, office or my juniors are going to take this information? How are they going to perceive this information? I know this person will react very negatively because certain negative events happened with them in the office. I know this person usually will be fine with it because that is how he perceives. He is easygoing. Okay, so different people will have different ways. Perception builds character that defines different roles individuals fall into. The clown, the hypocrite, the self-righteous, the victim. So it is also our perception that kind of helps in development of our personality. Not in a good way or a bad way, that this person is good, this person is a bad personality, but the way people react to their life situations, right? It is completely based on their perception, right? And perception is basically a result of what? It is a result of how you have seen the world growing up, what your preferences have been, what the things that have been told to us growing up. That all builds our perception. And perception is also a big indicator of now ultimately how our personality turns out. That people say it in very loose term that, you know, this person always thinks negatively. Yeah, any good thing happens, this person is, you know, always optimistic, is always easygoing. Why? In a way, it is also indicating that this person's perception to life is more easygoing. This person's perception towards life is more negative, right? So that is how you can, you know, sort of see a relationship between human behavior, human personality and perception. It is vitally important if we want to get along with others to try to see things from their perspective or walk in their shoes for a while. If we walk in their shoes, we will gain a new perspective about things, and in that understand the other person also and can help the other person more appropriately. This is mostly important in our practice when we work as psychologists, because psychologists are also human beings. We are also coming from our own experiences, our own personal biases, our own personal perceptions about people and their life. But we are taught to have more empathy. We are taught to be more neutral, because otherwise we are not supposed to impose our perception on the person we are dealing with. We have to be very neutral. We have to take on their perspective, how their perspective is right in their life circumstances, and how my perception will not fit there, right? Also teaching the patients ultimately, even in their, you know, counseling sessions, that how they can try to adapt a more flexible way of modifying their perception, because maybe their perception is very negatively biased. So everything that is happening, they are viewing negatively. So we also ask our question, you know, in our therapeutic techniques, we ask our patients this, that, okay, this is the problem, this is how you solved it, this is what you did when this happened to you. What do you think are some other ways this problem could be looked at? Or if your friend was in this same situation, what advice would you give them? Right? So what is basically we are doing here is that we are forcing them to broaden their angles of perception. We are basically telling them to look at the same situation from different angles and different ways, right? So having a broader perspective towards life situations, having a broader perspective towards life problems and events that, you know, happen in day-to-day living, that is also very important. Okay, now what are the factors affecting perception? When an individual looks at a target and attempts to interpret what he or she sees, for example, that interpretation is heavily influenced by the personal characteristics of the individual perceiver. So, if I am looking at a certain object, or if I am looking at a particular set of clothing, or if I am looking at a particular food item, right, how I interpret it, I have seen it through my vision, that is sensation, right, that is done. Now, how I give meaning to it depends on my personal attributes, okay. These personal characters that can be my first thing is attitude, okay. What sort of attitude I have, positive or negative, how much interested I am in that particular set of, you know. Yes, sir. Yeah, there's some trouble. Laptop is not getting connected. Okay. So, it can be my attitude. It can be also my personality. Okay. It can be my motives. It can be my interest, past experience and expectations. Now, in the back of my mind, I have this thing that, you know, I have the same clothes. I haven't shopped in a while. And then I'm not going out for the motivation of shopping clothes, but I just enter a market and I am in my visual space, there are many things, but subconsciously I am giving more attention to the clothing section, right, because my, and I'm not doing it consciously, but some way or the other in the visual field I am focused on the clothing, that you know, what sort of clothes are there, what collection is there. Right? So, it is also my interest and my motives that is somehow affecting my perception. Also, it can be my past experiences and my expectations that I already discussed with you all. Now, there are some other factors also that influence the target, such as novelty. Novelty ka matlab hota hai newness. Motion, sound, size, background, proximity, similarity, etc. I'll come to this one by one. Characteristics of the target being observed can affect what is perceived. Because targets are not looked at in isolation, the relationship of the target to its background also influences perception, as does our tendency to group close things and similar things together. Okay, so in a visual field, it's not like that I am right now only and only able to see the table, or that I am only right now able to see one student. At one point I am viewing a lot of things, and at the same time it can happen that in this classroom only I am focusing on certain students and that is changing. So my, you know, visual field is also constantly changing and so is my perception. So perception is related to a lot of such things. There are also some situational factors like the time of perceiving others, work setting, social setting, which influence our perception process. Besides this, there are other factors like perceptual learning, which is based on past experiences, or any special training that we get. Every one of us learns to emphasize some sensory inputs and tends to ignore the other. Okay, so when you are focusing in the class right now, you're attending to more of your, you know, auditory and your visual sensation, right? And then next, when you are, you know, after all your classes, you are hungry and you go to the cafeteria, your focus will not be so much seeing or hearing. Your focus will be more on your taste buds, okay? So, that is how it can also change that which sensory input we are more attending to. Such expectancy keeps the individuals prepared with good attention and concentration. The level of knowledge we have may also change the way we perceive his or her behavior. Now, there are certain other factors that influence perception. First is personal characteristics, like I have already talked about, like past experiences, motivation, learning, right? A musician quickly learns the pattern of tones that make a melody and detects a discordant note, okay? So, if already a person is trained in certain things, they are quick to interpret something that is related to their profession or something that is related to their hobby. So, you know, we all are sitting together and there's a musician among us, there's some sound, some music. Their attention will quickly go on that and interpreting the musical sound, the tone, the intonation, all of that. Then next is motivation. While an individual may not be initially having a taste for espresso coffee, if the person's group of acquaintances perceived this as a very, you know, in beverage, he or she may then start drinking espresso, okay? So, through our interest or through other people's persuasion also, our perception towards certain things change. We don't like to have coffee, but somebody else says we should have coffee, coffee is a cool thing to have, and our perception towards it can change. Okay, another concept in perceptual constancy that I would like to cover is that all of the human beings and also animals, there is a tendency to maintain constancy in terms of size, color and shape. In the perception of stimuli, even though the stimuli has changed, for example, you recognize that a small brown colored dog in the distance as your neighbor's large golden retriever, so you aren't surprised by the great increase in size or the appearance of the yellow color when he comes to you. And in spite of the changes in the appearance of the dog moving toward you from a distance, you still perceive the shape as that of a dog, no matter from which angle you are seeing the dog, right? So if, you know, that same dog is pretty far away, of course sensation wise the size is small, but in your mind you are perceiving that the dog of the same size, that you know that dog. You know that dog, you know, is brown, and when the dog is coming closer to you, you know, okay, yeah, this is the size of the dog, this is how the dog looks, it is brown in color. So you are not really surprised by its change in shape and size, even if it is at a distance or even if it is viewed from a different angle, because your perception is already set that this dog is supposed to be of this size and this color. So distance and stuff does not really change how you perceive the dog shape, color, size and all of those things, right? It can be applied to any example. You are seeing your friend walking away from far, right? Visually the size is small, right? If you really think about it, wo jo image aapke eyes mein banti hai, wo choti banti hai. But in your mind, you are viewing that friend of that same height, right? You are still able to recognize that friend from a different angle and what they look like. Just because they are far, it does not change their shape or size, at least in your mind and how you are perceiving them, right? So perception works like that. There is a certain, what I just talked about is basically called size constancy, color constancy and shape constancy, no matter from which angle the particular stimulus is viewed, okay? Now there are also certain organization of perception which is based on principles which are prevalent in the gestalt psychology. First is that stimulus characteristics affect organization. Important stimulus characteristics that affect organization of stimuli and perception include the following. First is closure. Closure is the completion of an incomplete stimulus. If somebody yells at us that close the dash, the word door isn't said, but somewhere in your mind you fill in the blank because of the past experiences and you close the door. So even if the door word wasn't said, in your mind you are programmed that this person always tells me to close the door. So even if door word wasn't said, it was perceived in your mind that they are talking about door, and you instantly act on it by closing the door, right? Sometimes it also happens that we are, you know, reading a sentence on a newspaper or in a book, and the book, you know, maybe the book is not binded together, so the last word is not that much visible, or that there is a misprint, or that the word is omitted by some spelling mistake. But when you are reading, your mind has a habit of completing it, even though that word is not present, but you know how it would have ended, okay? So that is also that you, in your mind, you are programmed to give closure to that particular sentence, okay? Next is nearness. Stimuli that is near one another tend to be grouped together. Stars near one another are sometimes seen as pattern of constellation, which is not the case for stars that are far apart, okay? So we view certain stimuli together, right? We perceive them together, even if physically they are far off. Our mind has a habit of perceiving things in groups that are near. So if 4-5 students are, you know, sitting together, I'm viewing them as a group. The stars that I'm looking at, since they are near, I'm viewing it as a constellation. So our mind has a tendency to group things together that are near to each other, and that ends up affecting our perception as well. Next is similarity. Stimuli that is similar to one another are frequently grouped together. People wearing the same band uniforms are seen as similar compared to a group of marching people who are wearing everyday clothes. So we have a tendency to group things that look similar together. Okay? There is also a principle of continuity. The tendency is to view a figure, pattern or illustration that contains gaps as smooth and continuous rather than as discontinuous. The broken line down the middle of the highway is perceived as a continuous dotted line rather than a long row of blocks. Okay? And even if you see an object, or even if you see a drawing in which there are certain dots that are close, you know, put close together, right? You are not viewing them as individual dots. Your mind tries to form them as a circle. Okay? You try to group things together. That is also one principle of perception. Next is contiguity. Contiguity or nearness in time and space also influences our perception. If certain theme songs and visual stimuli are placed near the beginning or end of television program, these stimuli are associated with the starting or stopping of the program. So you tend to group things together which are happening repetitively. You watch TV shows, you watch all of these things, right? So you know that this music comes when the show ends. This music comes when the show starts, even though you are not consciously paying attention to it. Okay? So this is the contiguity principle of perception. And that's why you have perceived that, okay, this show is going to start now, or this show is going to end. Okay? So far, are you all able to understand what perception is? Okay. Next thing is the Gestalt theory. Gestalt theory is a group of early experimental psychologists known as Gestalt psychologists that believe that perceptions are more than the stimuli that create them. By more, they basically said that it is meant as meaningful. Whole pattern is created by the stimuli. Basically, Gestalt theory says that the total is more than the sum of its parts. These psychologists developed the idea that stimuli can be grouped and seen as a whole. These psychologists believe that the innate organizing tendencies of our brain would explain organization functions in perception, including many optical illusions, for example, the phi phenomena and the certain figure ground relationship. Phi phenomena hota hai, it occurs when you see two adjacent lights alternatively blinking off and on, and what we do is that we end up perceiving it as one light, right? You can often see these sort of phenomena in your traffic lights, in your road lights, that there are two adjacent lights that are blinking on and off, which is creating an illusion that it is one single line. Okay, so that is the phi phenomena. Next is the figure ground principle. These figure ground principles are important in Gestalt theory, which suggests that perceptions are organized to produce a figure ground effect. One tends to see objects against backgrounds rather than to view each separately. However, when instructed, one may invert the relationship and see the object as background and vice versa, right? It is happening, right? So if you all are viewing me, for you, I can be the main object and this wall can be the background. But if you change your perception given as per instructions, you can start viewing me in the background and this, wall in the forefront. So this is known as figure and background. So this is our mind's process that I'm not viewing all of you independently. I am viewing certain students in the foreground and certain students in the background. At the same time, if I want, through my visual field, some students can appear to me in foreground and others can be in the background. Okay, so that is also one Gestalt principles of figure and ground. Okay, the next thing that we will cover in this unit is depth and distance perception, how we all perceive how deep a particular stimulus is or how much distance it is at. There are various principles to it and what all factors are there which, you know, help us in deciding. There are certain cues, there are certain textures, there are certain size principles that affect it. That and all I will take up in the next class, because I need to explain it properly also, and you know, it should be visible to you in your slides. So I'll take that up in the next class. For today, you all have to know about what is perception, how perception is different from sensation, then also about the fact that perception is both a bottom-up process and a top-down process. You also have to know about the importance of perception in human psychology and how perception is basically helping in understanding human behavior and individual differences in human behavior. And also about the factors that are affecting perception, which are attitude, motives, personality, life experiences, right? All of these things. And then ultimately, the perceptual constancy concept, okay? And the certain gestalt principles of closure, nearness, similarity, continuity, congenuity, okay? So that is all for today. In the next class, I will take up the depth perception aspect of this unit. Okay? You are